championship belongs to the Los Angeles Lakers.
Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. Trevor Lane here for LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers season review time. Today, we're talking about Kyle Kuzma, the chameleon, the boy who lived, the sole survivor, whatever you want to call him. What was his season like for the Lakers? It definitely was not what we expected. And will he survive yet again this offseason? I'm inclined to say no, and I want to dive into why. But joining me is Ron Gutterman from LakersNation.com. Ron, let's talk a little Kyle Kuzma.
Yeah, and this is, we talked about Dennis Schroeder as the most interesting person to talk about in terms of the amount of ways that he and the Lakers can go with free agency. But I think Kyle Kuzma might be the most controversial person to talk about just because the opinions about him are so drastically different. There are people saying he is the worst player to ever exist and the Lakers need to ship him off for a bag of peanuts. And then there's people saying that, no, he provides value to this team and he needs to be here. It's very interesting.
It really is. You know, I've seen more trade Kuzma comments than any other player on the team by a long shot, right? I mean, I've seen a lot of people that want to let Dennis Schroeder go that don't want to, you know, to agree with Magic Johnson and say he's just not a Laker. But I'm seeing more people that are saying trade Kuzma than any other player, which is nothing new. He's been in trade rumors from day one as a Laker, and that way I kind of sympathize with him. I mean, he shut down his social media last year because every single time he logged on, he was just getting bombarded by people saying, hey, we want to trade you, trade him to this team, trade him to that team, and they're tagging him in these posts saying, trade Kuzma here, trade Kuzma there. That's going to be frustrating for him. But in terms of his game this season, before we get into whether or not they're actually going to move him, what did you see? Let's start with the good. What are the positives you saw from Kyle Kuzma this season?
I saw a player who finally, after 3 years in the NBA, finally learned what his role is in the NBA. For the first 3 years, he really tried to force the issue when it came to being a scorer, and it just wasn't working. His fit alongside LeBron was awkward. His fit alongside Anthony Davis was awkward. It never really seemed to work. And then magically, he worked really hard in the offseason, and he became a player who can just fill any need. It didn't need to be scoring, although sometimes it could be. It could be rebounding. It could be defense. It could be playmaking. He really became a much more versatile player, and so I really do appreciate Kuz for that. And we can get into the bad later, but that's really what I saw from him that I really liked this year.
Yeah, that was impressive, certainly. I mean, this is a guy who came in out of college as a scorer. That was it. Pretty much, if Kuzma didn't score 15 plus points, it was a bad game for him because he wasn't providing really much else. So if he wasn't scoring the basketball, if he didn't shoot the ball well, that was it. That was it. He had no chance to really help you out elsewhere. This season, Kuzma came in, looked around, said, okay, we've got scorers. I'm going to focus on everything else. I'm going to be a better wing defender. By the way, Kuzma did make the transition to small forward mostly this season. So that's something else to note. But he said, I'm going to be a better wing defender. I'm going to be a better rebounder. I'm going to help out there. I'm going to try to make sure that my shooting improves. And it did. Statistically, he shot his, well, just barely second highest three-point percentage of his career, 36%, just a hair lower than the 36% that he shot in his rookie season. So he brought his three-point shooting back up. His rebound numbers were up there too, especially compared to minutes played. This was his best rebound season when adjusted for minutes. And same thing with blocks. Thought he did a nice job coming over from the weak side and affecting some shots. He's not a one block per game guy or anything like that. But he made real strides in a lot of different areas that were not scoring. And not every player can do that. Not every player can just go, oh, my team doesn't really need my scoring, so I'm going to go do X, Y, and Z.
Yeah, definitely. It was great of him to recognize what the team needed, especially with wing defense. You know, the Lakers, outside of Kuzma, don't really have anyone to defend those 6'8", 6'9", 6'10 wings. And so Kuzma saying, you know what, I'm going to do that, was really helpful. And it's what gave the Lakers a lot of their opportunities defensively this year.
Now, let's get into the bad a little bit. And let me hit you with something that's a little bit damning here for Kyle Kuzma. Looking at overall net rating on the season. So just in terms of, are they better with him on the floor or off? Kyle Kuzma, compared to the guys who played a full season with the Lakers, so I'm taking out Damian Jones here. Kyle Kuzma is the only player The only player, and I'm leaving out Jared Dudley in this as well because of the injuries, the only player who really played this season who was a net negative on the Lakers, and not by a lot, he was a negative 0.6 per 100 possessions. So 0.6 points per 100 possessions when Kuzma was on the floor, the Lakers were down by, right? And that over 100%, that's a very small amount. So it's not like this is the end of the world, but it is interesting that he's the only one. Everybody else is positive. And when Kuzma is off the floor, the Lakers' net rating is a positive 6.9, which first of all is nice, but second of all, that means you're beating the team that you're playing by a decent amount when Kuzma's off the floor. So why is that happening? And when we're seeing him become kind of this Swiss Army knife that can adapt to whatever the Lakers need, why do the advanced stats show that they're better off without him?
I mean, look, a lot of it has to do with inconsistency. This is the biggest criticism of Kuzma. It was his criticism when he was a rookie. And even as he adapted his game, it remained his criticism. He is not consistent on a night-to-night basis. He could be your second-best player one night and then by far your worst player the next night. It is just not consistent enough with him. So I think the stats, which a negative 0.6 very much reflects that. He can be very good for you or he can be very bad. So holistically, he looks like he's just about dead even. I think that's the biggest thing. He just really, really needs to figure out a way to be the same player on a night-to-night basis.
And, you know, when we talk about, okay, on one hand, it's great that he recognized that the team doesn't need his scoring. The problem, and that's impressive, because, again, not a lot of players can do that, can say, oh, the team doesn't really need this skill set. I'm just going to develop a different skill set. Like, not many guys can do that, right? But one of the problems of the season was that when the Lakers suddenly needed his scoring, it was like he couldn't find it again. You know what I mean? Like Kyle Kuzma, the Lakers, they lose LeBron James, they lose Anthony Davis. You need somebody to put the ball in the basket. We said, okay, hey, Dennis Schroeder, he's going to step up, right? Yeah. Okay, Kyle Kuzma, he's going to be the guy that's going to really step up. This is his chance, right? Now we need him to score the basketball. Didn't really get going. We didn't see, again, no consistency there. It's like once he shut off that part of his game to a degree at the beginning of the season, he couldn't go back to it. And that was certainly a source of frustration for Lakers fans this season.
Definitely. And it was he was the leader in the clubhouse in terms of one thing that we talked about all season was how annoying it was, how frustrating it was that the Lakers were hesitant to shoot the ball. Mm-hmm. And Kyle Kuzma was the leader in the clubhouse there. He was hesitant to shoot threes, and he ended up shooting a pretty decent percentage, but he was really hesitant. You could tell in the back of his mind that he didn't trust his own jump shot, and you could tell in the actions of the rotations that Frank Vogel and the coaching staff didn't really trust his jump shot. So it's one of those things where he needed to be able to adapt his skill set without completely losing the thing that made him good in the first place.
Yeah, agreed. And that was certainly an issue for him. Now, in terms of three-point attempts, I mean, he attempted more threes than at any other point during his career so far. But I think in terms of the overall flow of the offense, we did see him as one of the main culprits that was turning down open looks when he should have. And part of that is Frank Vogel. And let's not put this all on Kyle Kuzma. Part of that is Frank Vogel, because Frank Vogel was going out of his way to praise Kuzma to the media when Kuzma would start turning down shots. So he would start a game hot and he would hit, you know, two or three or something like that. And then he would go until the fourth quarter before shooting the ball again. And Frank Vogel would say, oh, no, this is great for Kyle Kuzma that he's being so selective with his shooting. He's not just gunning. And he's not necessarily wrong there, but we did see, and I think it came back to bite the Lakers later on, we did see a little bit of hesitation from Kuzma, and that's something that has to be changed. But I guess that leads us to our bigger topic, though. Does he finally get traded? I mean, when I'm looking at that contract that he's now on, $13 million once the league calendar rolls over to next season, to me, that is a very, very tradable piece. And his position on the wing is one that a lot of teams in the NBA want.
Yeah, and trading Kuzma is obviously a popular topic among Lakers fans. I'm hesitant because while I do think that trading him could net you some value, I think trading away Kuzma would mean you'd lose your only wing, your only big wing defender, the only guy on the team who provides you what Kuzma does is Kuzma. So if you trade him, you're now completely lost at a very particular skill set that you need in the NBA. So I am hesitant about trading him, but I understand why it's such a popular topic among Lakers fans.
I mean, he's still young enough where teams could talk themselves into him being a guy that they really want. But I think you bring up a good point, though. The challenge with trading Kuzma is you need to replace him with another guy who does the things that he does. Now, maybe you can find a guy who does those things a little bit better, but that's not easy because every team in the NBA is after that, a guy who can defend and shoot the three and handle the ball. By the way, he did say he's going to be working on his ball handling a lot this offseason. I don't know how I feel about that. I don't know if that's really where he needs to focus on. I think he just needs to become the best shooter and defender he can be. And then the ball handling, if that's not a huge part of his game, is that really the worst thing in the world for a wing player? I don't think so. But no. I can see where he could improve there too. But let me hit you with this, Ron. Kentavious Caldwell-Pope and Kyle Kuzma have almost the same contract. Kuzma has one more year on it, but they both have a non-guaranteed final year, or at least a partially non-guaranteed. Oh, wait, Kuzma has a player option at the end. Sorry. Kuzma has a player option at the end of his.
Interesting.
KCP has a little, yeah. KCP has a portion of his contract is non-guaranteed in the final season. But for next season, they have almost the same deal, $13 million. Which one do you think is more likely, because they're so similar, you need to put one of them into a trade. Which one do you think teams would prefer to get in a deal if it was that, if you had to add in one of them in order to make salaries work?
I think KCP has slightly more value, but I think Kuzma is more likely to be traded.
Okay.
Just because Kuzma is younger, he has interesting skill sets. He's a big wing. Teams really like that. KCP is more valuable because he can shoot the three with regularity, with some consistency. He fits today's NBA very well. I just think Kuzma is more likely to be traded because I think the age really will help the Lakers get a little bit more of what they're looking for. KCP, there's not really a lot of guys that teams are going to say, let's give you a star for your spot up 3-point shooter. But they might say, hey, you're 25-year-old wing. It's an interesting debate. I think Kuzma is a little more likely to be traded.
Yeah, I agree. I think that KCP has the trust of LeBron James. And so if it's just, we need $13 million in salary, and not so much a team saying, hey, this is what we really want in the deal is Kuzma or KCP. If they're somewhere equal and it's just we need $13 million in salary, I think the Lakers would keep KCP over Kyle Kuzma. Because, again, KCP has the trust of LeBron James. You can say the contract is a year shorter, and, of course, that matters. But still, I think KCP's got that trust. Kuzma, I don't know, because you don't know for sure what you're going to get out of him. And again, that's not all on him. Season to season, he's been asked to change his role every single year. Every single year, his role has changed. I do think he might thrive in another location, but I think we're at that point. I think that his luck has probably run out in terms of being the guy who's always in trade rumors but never gets moved. I think this is the year we finally see him get moved this offseason here.
So my question to you, with that being said, since you believe this is finally the rumor mill that moves him, what is the return on that deal? And you don't even need to say a specific player. You can say a specific player, but what are the Lakers getting when they're trading Kuzma?
I think they're getting shooting. I think that's what they go after with him is some type of a shooter. And it might be a guard, and then maybe you make a different move to add a wing defender somewhere down the line. But I think that it's going to be a move to get a consistent shooter out there because that was such a glaring weakness. And I think he is one of the better trade chips that they've got, right, in their war chest. So I do think that he gets moved in a deal to land a shooter. And I know there's tons of names that are out there. People have been throwing out a bunch of them. But whoever they go after, I think you're going to need his salary in any kind of a deal to land the kind of player the Lakers are going to be after. And I'm talking about a non-superstar, maybe best case scenario, we're talking about like a fringe all-star type player. And in order to get a guy like that, you're going to need Kuzma's salary in there.
Yeah, I could see that. Yeah, it's very interesting. I think Kuzma, again, the most controversial of any Laker in terms of the varying degrees of people liking him or disliking him. I'm very intrigued to see where the Lakers go with him over the next few months.
Like, if you could, just to throw one name out there, how does Luke Walton feel about Kyle Kuzma? Does he enjoy his time with him? Like, if it's Kyle Kuzma and stuff, right, your first-round pick, maybe the 22nd overall, and another contract to get you there, to get Buddy Hield, you're doing that deal, right?
Well, let me ask you this. Yeah. So you're the Lakers. You're the Lakers. Mm-hmm. And the Kings say, we will give you Buddy Hield. In exchange, we need Kyle Kuzma, the 22nd overall pick in the draft, and we need – trying to think. I don't want to throw in THT because I don't think they would ask for THT.
They might. He's the sticking point. But you would need, because of his contract, you would need – Like if Trez opted into his deal suddenly, like he would probably be the contract to go into something like that.
Yeah, so it need to be something along those lines. Maybe Kuz the 22nd pick, and it's really difficult. I don't even know what else the Kings would want. They wouldn't ask for THT, but you're saying you would do that deal if it's Kuz 22nd pick and another piece that's not THT.
Yeah, I would do that. Now, I mean... Salary-wise, there's maybe something you can look at there. But in terms of overall fit, in terms of value, in terms of what the Lakers need, yeah, I would do that deal, and then I would be looking to find a wing defender with another move down the road.
Yeah, I definitely could see it. It's a lot of options with Kyle Kuzma, for sure.
Definitely. But viewers, let us know what you think. Do you agree with me? Do you think that Kyle Kuzma is on his way out the door? And again, I'm going to say this. I've been saying it all offseason so far. This is not because I don't like Kyle Kuzma, but I think logistically, his salary, that $13 million salary, is much easier to move and is probably going to be needed in a trade. So, do you agree with me that Kyle Kuzma probably gets moved this offseason? Let me know in the comments down below. And don't forget, subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel and ring that notification bell as well. Till next time, stay safe and see you.